It's an honor for me as the mayor to say a couple of things about Steve and give Steve an award to the city. Whereas the city of Paris periodically honors one of its past citizens for his accomplishments to the betterment of mankind. And whereas our honoree, Dr. Stephen Ellich, who graduated from Paris High School in 1964, and whereas he earned his B.S. in chemistry in 1978 from the University of Illinois, however, it was not until his junior year abroad at the University of Southampton in England that he received a spark of interest in biology. Upon returning to U of I to complete his bachelor's degree, he applied for graduate programs in chemistry and biology and was accepted to a little place called Massachusetts Institute of Technology, MIT, where he performed his and then obtained his PhD degree in biology. In 1984, he began his postdoctoral fellowship at Stanford University in California. If you're going to hear all these universities, you're going to know that everywhere that he's gone, everywhere he's studied, are places that I used just to dream about maybe being able to send an application, let alone get in. He began his work in genetics, which led to a job offer at Baylor College of Medicine in Houston, Texas in 1989. While at Baylor, Steve's research led to numerous discoveries, which led to numerous publications and acknowledgments from international medical and science world, which also led to just a few awards. NAS Award for Molecular Biology in 2002. Genetic Society of America Medal 2005. Dixon Prize, 2010. Gardner, I think that's how it is, on the Foundation International Award, 2013. Albert Lasker Award for Basic Medical Research, 2015. Breakthrough Prize of Life Sciences, which I'll talk to you about a little bit later, in 2016. And the Gerber Prize of Genetics in 2017. The Breakthrough Prize of Life Sciences was established by a couple of tycoons by the name of Yuri Milner and Mark Zuckerberg, who I'm sure you all know started Facebook. They're both multiple billionaires. And they decided, and their belief was, that our society should celebrate scientists who achieve and advance our understanding in the world as much as we celebrate actors, athletes, and entrepreneurs. The Breakthrough Prize is the biggest money prize in science, and it's also been called the Oscar of Science. Steve was awarded $3 million for the Life Science Prize for his contributions to biology, including discovering mechanisms of cell division, cell aging, protein breakdown, and cancer growth. And whereas Steve is currently the Gregor Mendel Professor of Genetics at Brigham and Women's Hospital and Harvard Medical School. Continues to look for new discoveries and has recently been developing a way to track every virus an individual has come in contact with over the course of his or her lifetime. And I'm quoting Steve's work toward elucidating the way cells sense DNA damage and initiate self-repair is breathtaking in its scope and elegance. That was said by Barbara McNeil, acting dean at Harvard Medical School. She went on to state that his passion for discovery, his curiosity, and creativity embody the spirit of Harvard Medical School and the noblest traditions in scientific thought and inquiry. His work provides insights into how DNA works, how to fix itself, when it's broken, all of those are key process for those who analyze and develop the treatment of cancer. And whereas the above represents only a handful, and believe me, it is only a handful of accomplishments that this man has done and his activities which he's been involved in for the last 30 years. His work is making our country and world a better place for us to live. His knowledge and discoveries will have a direct impact on all of us and our future in improving all human health. He is truly an ambassador for the city of Paris, and Paris is fortunate today to bestow upon him the key to the city. Now, therefore, it's my pleasure that I proclaim as mayor of the city of Paris, Dr. Stephen Elledge Week, from September 1, 2017 through September 8, 2017. This proclamation is made in honor, to honor and recognize Dr. Elledge for his many accomplishments, his dedication to science and medicine, and his research that has and will lead to equality for better improvement of quality of life in all humans. Steve, it's my honor to present you with the key to the city.
Looking stupid, right? You can't, and if people are going to think you're stupid, If you ask a question, they probably already think you're stupid anyway, so what difference does it make? They're judgmental, who cares about them anyway? But you can't worry about that, you know? You can't be afraid to ask the question that enlightens you, or else you're going to remain ignorant. And there's nothing wrong with being ignorant. I mean, everyone starts out ignorant, right? It's not shameful to be ignorant. But what's shameful is allowing yourself to remain ignorant and then pretending it's cool, because it's not. That cells that get really damaged so that you can't fix them, they undergo a process that's called senescence, which means that they change and stop growing forever. And this prevents cancer, so it's really important. If you don't senesce properly, you can get cancer. But these cells also secrete inflammatory molecules that alert the immune system, which probably is a good thing in small doses. But as we age, we accumulate more and more of these, and then your whole body becomes more inflammatory. And so people have shown in mice that if you kill the cells that are senescent, the mice actually live longer and don't grow old as fast. So my lab's figured out part of how the mechanism works to turn on the inflammation pathway, and we're working on ways to try to kill these cells that could have interesting implications for aging and health. We also work, you know this guy? Has anybody seen this guy before? Walter? He's a friend of mine. Also a scientist, I want you to know. Chemist, as a matter of fact. We study what happens when chromosomes get broken and when you get too many chromosomes or too few. It's called aneuploidy. And aneuploidy is important for cancer. These are all of your chromosomes, and this is just a heat map showing that if you look at lots of cancers, you see some of them lose chromosomes in dark blue, or sometimes the chromosomes are gained. And so cancers often have the wrong numbers of chromosomes or parts of chromosomes. But for a long time, no one understood what that meant. They thought this just might be a passenger event. But my group has shown that, in fact, this is actually something that drives the cancer. And we figured out how it works. And we do that by integrating lots of data sets. So biology and all science now is involved with big data and extracting information out of big data. And so it's really important to have the mathematical tools to do that. So a big growth area for anyone who's interested in this sort of method and how to deal with big data, which also, by the way, has a lot of implications for social networks and things too, is learning how to do bioinformatics and statistical analysis. Another thing my lab has developed methods to probe the immune system to look at what your antibodies are looking at. We developed a method to look at all the antibodies in your body that recognize viruses, because every time you get an infection, your body makes a permanent footprint of antibodies that recognize the viruses. So we can now detect that, and I can have a drop of your blood to tell you what viruses you've been infected with. And we also can do this for autoimmunity. So we now develop methods to look to see if your body's attacking itself with autoantibodies, that we can find those antibodies and figure out what they're seeing. So we're trying to learn the language of the immune system. My lab has also worked on protein death. So sometimes it's important for a cell to destroy a protein. Sometimes they make them, sometimes they want to get rid of them. How do they pick which ones that they want to do? So my lab has done a lot of work on figuring that out. I really love science, and I love being able to figure out biological puzzles. It's just such a blast. And you might think that, I went to school for a long time. I'm like, God, I've got a degree, and a bachelor's degree, and a PhD, and a postdoc work. It takes too long, but actually, it's not even work for us. It's just, what you want to do, and they actually pay, and you get a degree at the end, but it's really about things that you like. And, it's hard to describe the feeling of discovering something and learning something new that no one's known before. I have a lot of respect for the scientists that I meet and the doctors. These people work really hard trying to out to get it right. I mean, these people are dedicated. And, you know, they, if one of them makes a mistake, the other people will correct it. In the literature, publicly, you know, they won't let anybody get by with saying something that's wrong. And they don't have loyalty to people. They just want to get things right. You know, and so, you know, it always sort of bothers me when people start claiming that scientists are making stuff up. You know, that I know they're wrong, and I actually take it personally. And I saw this quote I want to read to you about defending science. And this person said, "It interests me that seemingly no one is taking issue with scientists predicting an eclipse. No one's saying scientists have been wrong before, so I'm not going to trust them about this. No one's insisting that it's all part of some massive conspiracy. No one's claiming that they can predict eclipses better than scientists because it's something they read online. Indeed, everyone seems quite content to admit that scientists are competent and have a really good understanding of the physical world. Everyone implicitly accepts that scientists know more about science than they do. So then why is it that on topics like climate change, vaccines, evolution, suddenly everyone thinks that they know more than scientists do?" And, I think that you really have to think about things for yourself. And if someone's telling you that the scientists have some agenda, you should think twice about it. I'm a scientist, I know. If someone was wrong, and I had a chance to disprove them, I wouldn't hesitate. So I just want to say a few more things about what I see is the generation, your generation's challenges in science and in the world moving forward. Because every generation has their challenges. And I'm just going to mention four of the many that your generation is going to have to deal with. So one of them is dealing with antibiotics failure. And, you know, antibiotics save millions and millions of people's lives, maybe billions. But they're going bad. And bacteria, they become resistant to these antibiotics. And so your generation is going to have to figure out how to save our bodies. Because if we run out of antibiotics, a simple scratch on your finger can kill you. The other thing that you're going to have to solve is climate change. And basically, you're literally going to have to save the planet on this one. This is a big deal, and the climate is changing, and people are responsible for that. And it's something that we can actually deal with. I mean, it's not like we can't stop it. We can stop it, but there's money involved. You know, it's going to cost somebody a lot of money, or so they think. And they're lobbying against it. And in the meantime, they're blaming the scientists, saying, "Oh, it's not settled science," and things like that. And we heard all this before when the tobacco companies were trying to convince people that smoking didn't cause cancer. It does. And I'm surprised they can still let them not sell it. That's something else that's discussed. But, you know, when you think about, you know, the cost of something, I'm always drawn to this comment. There's this story called Pascal's Wager. Pascal was mathematician, he was trying to decide whether to believe in God or not. And he said, well, you know, he did sort of a cost-benefit analysis. He goes, well, you know, if I believe in God, if I don't believe in God, I'm wrong, I'm going to burn in hell for eternity. And he says, but if I do believe in God, I'm wrong, it's just going to cost me some time. So he's going to have his bets on that. And that's sort of the way I look at climate change. It will cost some money, but it's not that much money, and we can deal with it. And if we don't, there will be hell to pay. So think about that. So another challenge I think that's really on the rise, Elon Musk talks about this a lot, is the emergence of artificial intelligence. Now, machine learning is something I use in my own lab to extract information out of data, and eventually computers are going to be diagnosing people and they can do it better than people can. I've seen this stuff firsthand. It's amazing. There's so much information out there. We as human beings can only access some of it. But we can also get machines to become intelligent. And someday we're going to be able to think better than humans. And you know, we think, oh, we go out into outer space, are we going to meet people like ourselves in outer space? The answer is no. We're going to be intelligent machines. That's who we're going to meet when the SETI project finds intelligent life. And you might just ask yourself, well, how can that be? They're just machines. How can they be more intelligent than us? And I think you just have to remember that we're just machines too. You know, we're just made out of amino acids. We are physical reality, and there's no reason why machines can't learn to think is better than us, as well or better than us, and then begin to evolve because we evolve. Another topic I think is going to be really important is something I call mind control. I don't know if that's the right phrase for it, but I just want to read this quote from Tristan Harris. He's a former Google design ethicist. He said, "Without realizing the implications, a handful of tech leaders at Google and Facebook have built the most pervasive, centralized systems for steering human attention that has ever existed. While enabling skilled actors, such as addictive apps, bots, foreign governments, to hijack our attention for manipulative purposes." So the fact that two information sources, Facebook and Google, have an unprecedented influence over our information uptake, this is a tremendous potential problem of mind control. And we really have to think about the information that you're getting in the sources. And now in the post-truth era, the era of fake news, you really have to think, about how you react to the information that you get. I just want to add a couple more quotes. This is from Albert Einstein. "Few people are capable of expressing with equanimity opinions which differ from the prejudices of their social environment." This is just to express them. "Most people are even incapable of forming such opinions." And I wanted to add a second quote, which is on a church sign in Northern Ireland. It said, "If we'd been born where they were born and taught what they were taught, we would believe what they believe." So the key here is that you have to think for yourself. You know, we are a product of our environment and what we've been told. But you have to figure out what reality is for yourself. That means you have to take a skeptical look at any information that you get. So you really have to think. You have to question what you're told. You have to gather your own facts and think about them. And you have to figure out the truth for yourself. And it may be very different from what your friends think. And it may be feeling really uncomfortable not to go along with everything. But you really have to do this. You have to question. And this is what scientists do. They question, they think. But we're all really scientists on the inside, trying to figure out what's real and what's not. So I just want to give you this take-home message here. You know, this is about growing up in Paris and going out and becoming part of the world. When you think of all the famous people you've read about, all the artists and actors and entrepreneurs and inventors and writers and our own rock star, Fred Eldridge, a good percentage of these people came from some place just like Paris.
I need Chloe, Waltz, and John Durant to the front office. Chloe, Waltz, and John Durant to the front office.
Hurry. And, these people are from places just like this. And they decided they want to strike out on their own and do something, and you can do that too if that's what you want in life. You know, it doesn't matter what other people think about you. It's really about yourself. It doesn't matter what your parents think. It doesn't matter what your teachers think, what your friends say about you. The only thing that matters is what you think and what you want to do with your life. And this isn't about science. It's about anything. Anything you want to do with your life. Anything and everything. You want to make furniture, then you can learn about it. Or you want to be a plumber, or electrician, or auto mechanic, or a nurse, or a teacher, learn it. You can learn it. You can be the best at it. You know, you can own it. You can take pride in it. So, you know, if I can do that, anyone can. So if you set your mind to it and apply yourself, you can accomplish your goals, no matter where you start. So, thank you for your attention.